trembling at his feet we saw, Moses and Elijah speaking, all the prophets and the law, shout through them their joyful greeting. Praise and glory, praise and glory, praise and glory to our Lord. All the prophets and the law, shout through them their joyful greeting.
With the cloud of glory came, God proclaiming in his thunder, Jesus as the Son by name. Nations cry aloud in wonder. Praise and glory, praise and glory, praise and glory to our Lord. Jesus as the Son by name. Nations cry aloud in wonder. Jesus chosen one, living above every nation. Hear and heed him, everyone. Sing with earth and all creation. Praise and glory, praise and glory, praise and glory to our Lord. Hear and
welcome, St. Stephen's, to worship on this Transfiguration Sunday. It is my great pleasure to tell you that the Reverend Phil Spencer is back in the pulpit today as Diane takes some well-deserved time away. Phil, for those of you that don't know, was the minister here for 27 years. He and Foster are great friends, and so the intrepid three, Phil, Foster and Diane, have known each other and worked together for many years. I trust that Phil's message is timely and will be well received today. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please join me in the call to worship for today. Rejoice, people of God. Celebrate the life within you and Christ's presence in your midst. Our eyes shall be opened. The present will have new meaning, and the future will be bright with hope. Rejoice, people of God. Bow your heads before the one who is our wisdom and our strength. We place ourselves before our God that we may be touched and cleansed by the power of God's Spirit. If you light a candle as you enter into worship, let's do that together. As I light the Christ candle here, recognizing Jesus, the light of the world. Let's pray together. God of power and wonder, we are awestruck by the glory of your presence. We rejoice at what we can see. We marvel at what we cannot see. You dazzle us with your brightness. You overshadow us as with a great cloud. Loving, protecting, challenging, nurturing, you strengthen and transform us. May we love and serve you in all that we are and do. Glory be to you. Amen. In some ways, today's prayer of confession attempts to prepare our hearts for the season of Lent. Please pray this responsive prayer with me. Lord Jesus Christ, God's glory and love shone through you that day on the mountain, and you persisted in revealing that glory and love through your words and deeds, through your life of humble service. We hear again these wonderful words of God. You are my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him. We confess our failure to listen to you because of the influences on our lives of the gods of this world. When this happens, our attitudes conceal rather than reveal your glory and your love. If we conceal your love because of our pursuit of other priorities, prevents us from seeing and serving people in need, forgive us, Lord. If we conceal your glory because all we reflect is our own self-centeredness, forgive us, Lord. If we conceal your truth through our lack of credible witness, forgive us, Lord. If we conceal your justice through our failure to empower those who are powerless, forgive us, Lord. If we conceal your mercy because of our hard and unforgiving attitudes, forgive us, Lord. If we conceal your compassion because of our prejudice and intolerance, forgive us, Lord. Lord Jesus Christ, cleanse our lives of all shameful attitudes of mind and heart, so that we reveal your glory in and through all we do and say and are. This we pray in your name and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
As the author of the letter to the Hebrews wrote, "Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Sisters and brothers, embrace the forgiveness that is yours this very day. And the people say, Amen.
Scripture reading is from Matthew 17, verses 1 to 9, from the New International Version. The Transfiguration. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. Just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah, talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and touched them. Get up, he said. Don't be afraid. When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus instructed them, "Don't tell anyone what you have seen until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." This is the end of our reading.
I'm now going to do something quite self-serving and lacking in the professionalism that you would reasonably expect of your preacher. As a good many of you know, Tevis and I finally became grandparents a couple of days before Christmas. Our daughter Eilish, with some help from her husband Brian, gave birth to a baby boy who bears the sturdy name of Olin Grant Statham. FYI, Olin clocked in at 8 pounds 3 ounces and has, yes, been growing like a weed since the day of his birth. He's playing with that adorable Michelin man look right now. So I'm going to take this opportunity, while you're presently helpless, to show you a few pictures of our new grandson, which, to be fair, will also save you from the experience of me cornering you in the church hall and forcing you to look at dozens of photos on my phone before I release you. So, here's the little guy on December 23rd, already deeply attached to his granddad, as I'm sure you can tell. And this is the lad, this is the second picture, a couple of weeks ago. This is the touchdown pose, which he seems to rather like for some reason. And then just one more. Here he is on his way out of the house and looking rather cute and gnome-like. I expect you are rather shocked to hear that we're rather enchanted by him. I could show you more, of course, though honesty does demand that I admit that it's not just delight in this sweet little boy that I show you these pictures, but also it's partly my feeble attempt to delay addressing what is the greater problem. And that's my discombobulation with today's Bible reading. This strange and otherworldly story of the transfiguration that we're asked to remember this morning on this, the last Sunday of the season of Epiphany. I know I haven't hidden the fact from you over the many other Transfiguration Sundays that I've stood here, but I find this to be an especially tough biblical text to preach on. I have most of my sermons squirreled away on my computer, so I did a little checking this last week. And yeah, I think most of the time I offered some version of, you know, preaching on this text isn't without its challenges, which is my euphemism for, well, I think I'm over my head on this one. I know this isn't true for all preachers, but it is for me. One of my approaches over the years is to quickly get to the next verses, which have Jesus and the disciples going down the mountain back to all the people. And it's like, I'm trying to say, you know, that's where the real work is. And, you know, playing that card that we can't constantly live on spiritual highs, but we need to get on with the difficult work of day-to-day living. Well, I confess that as I look back on it, it can sometimes be a form of preaching sleight of hand. Don't look over there where I'm uncomfortable, but over here where I think I have some answers. So as I've thought about this, I think my difficulty isn't disconnected from, say, preaching on the virgin birth, or somehow feeling the need to explain, you know, how Noah got all the animals on the ark, or preaching on Balaam's alarmingly talkative donkey, or to some extent even the resurrection. In that I suffer from this temptation to explain how this strange thing transpired. And just maybe that's just not the thing, the question that in the long run really matters. There's a lot of stuff that happens around us that defies anything approaching detailed explanation, and yet that stuff is nonetheless undeniably true in spite of all that. Our little boy Olin had my heart from the moment I held him, and I It was just like I experienced with his mother some 35 years before. And it crossed my mind in a flash that I loved him rather fiercely. And that, yeah, I suspect I'd be willing to offer up my life for his. And yet, like, where does that fierce form of love come from? By the way, one of the things that moves me so much is watching my daughter and her husband's world, well, it's turned upside down as they experience this astonishing love. Just as ours was rocked to its foundations when our children arrived and stayed. Some things aren't logical problems to be solved, but they are instead just glorious mysteries. Mysteries that will continue to provoke us and draw us deeper as long as we have breath. The way Matthew tells the story isn't that much different than the way the writers of Mark and Luke's gospel remember it. Interesting is that the writer of the Gospel of John doesn't tell the transfiguration story at all, though some do detect a rather oblique reference to it in that tour de force of a first chapter that he writes. And this is not a complaint. I've always found John to be otherwise especially generous in offering enigmatic and mysterious stories, but I'm just going to save John for a moment. As we heard in Matthew's version, the account begins with the statement, 6 days later, which makes me ask, 6 days after what? A little bit of biblical detective work? Okay. I read the previous chapter. And that reveals that this event is 6 days after Jesus famously asked the 12, "Who do you say that I am?" And you remember how Simon Peter asserts dramatically, "You're the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And then Jesus replies, no less vividly, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood hasn't revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." This would be a powerful affirmation to Matthew's first audience, who are most likely Jewish believers. They were hearing that this isn't simply a wise teacher or another prophet, but this Jesus fits into their story as the long-awaited Messiah. He'd finally arrived. And you may remember that Jesus goes on to prophesy about this, his death and resurrection, much to the horror of this same rock, Peter, on which Jesus has just said he's building his church. It was not the most promising start for our rocky, supposedly firm foundation. Though in fairness, I think we can see that he eventually does grow into the role rather well. But here we are, 6 days later, and Jesus leads the three of the disciples, the aforementioned Peter, and James and his brother John, up high mountain, Mount Tabor or Mount Hermon being the likely possibilities if you're passing through Galilee. So the scene is that they're on the mountain, and Matthew indicates that Jesus is transfigured. And not that commonly used word, at least in the Spencer household. And it's been defined as the giving of a new and usually exalted or spiritual appearance. And indeed we read that Jesus' face shone like the sun, and his clothes are as white as can be imagined. To add to the otherworldliness of the scene, Jesus is now joined by none other than Moses and Elijah, two of the greatest Old Testament figures, which means we have the embodiments of the law and the prophets bearing witness and pointing to Jesus as the Messiah. Our Peter is clearly flabbergasted by this, and really, I mean, who wouldn't be? This is well beyond normal human experience, and so he, and as many of us do when we don't know what to do, begins to babble on, and I get this. He rather inanely, at least to my ears anyway, suggests building some sort of monuments to commemorate the occasion, one for each of them, for Jesus and Moses and Elijah. And a word to the wise, if there's anything we know in recent years, Peter, it's that monuments don't usually age well. But I digress. Anyway, while he's still speaking, in my mind, he's desperately sketching out some sort of design on the ground, perhaps getting James and John to begin moving some boulders around. A cloud moves in above them, and a voice, Well, what am I kidding? The voice. It's the voice of God, right? God's voice interrupts our faithful but overwhelmed Peter, declaring, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased." And if that sounds familiar to you, yes. That's just what was said at Jesus' baptism back in chapter 3. Well, it's nearly what was said, but I'll return to that in a moment. Hearing the voice was, well, it totally pushed them over the edge. The disciples fall to the ground. They're terrified. But then Jesus comes over to them, touches them, reassures them, and then it's just Jesus and the three disciples. What to make of this? A few thoughts. I just recently read some of the writing by the psychologist Richard Beck, which has helped me approach this strange story in a slightly different way than I have in previous years. I mentioned Beck here about a half dozen years ago, I think, having found one of his books, Reviving Old Scratch, which is subtitled Demons and the Devil for Doubters and the Disenchanted. I found it surprisingly helpful, and I think we might even have it here in the church library. As I said, he's a psychologist. He self-describes as progressive theologically, and he's published some interesting perspectives on how the world, and curiously the church, has embraced disenchantment. And by that I mean, there was a time when we lived in an enchanted world, a society where we lived more comfortably with the notion of mystery, even magic, where we really did suspect, to quote Shakespeare's character Hamlet, that there are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. But somewhere in the last millennia, we began to shift into being a culture where science dominates. And this has brought with it a reductionism and a materialism that can sometimes accompany the scientific endeavor. An endeavor which has inarguably brought massive improvement to our lives. But as such, we now live in a world where science reigns supreme and tends to sweep aside the enchanted mystery. We don't like mysteries. We now live in a world where it seems like everything has or requires an explanation. And yes, I would like to know more about those balloons. But we'll save that for another day. With this shift towards scientific answers to most questions, we've also been steadily shifting our focus, which used to be on purpose, on the question of where all this was leading, to what is the end. And now we've instead become more focused on, well, what is the cause? And while we most readily acknowledge the importance of the journey in the Christian faith, we are by no means convinced that the journey is all there is. We also have an end in mind, a destination, and this is central to Jesus' teaching. It's not that we don't believe in a cause, it's just we know that there is a most glorious end awaiting, and that's what drives the journey. That's what gives us direction. And it helps us know how well our journey is going. In fact, without it, I believe the journey would be unsustainable and it would just crush us. Our world presently has shifted to being more attentive to cause than purpose. Or put more simply, we often seem to be more focused on how than why. But let me be so bold as to suggest that sometimes what is true or what is beautiful, or what is good, defies explanation and can only be contemplated, can only be gazed upon in awe. I'm now tempted to show you more baby pictures of our grandson, but let me show you another one instead. This is a very new baby who was born during or moments before or after the earthquake in Syria. And her mom, dad, and siblings all died there under the rubble. 10 hours after the earthquake, this little lass was dug out. She's been named Aya, which I'm told in Arabic means a sign from God. And I can only look at her in reverence, in awe. Friends, I've given it my best shot for about 40 years, but truthfully, the how of the Transfiguration is utterly beyond me. Indeed, I am of the opinion that it's really a beautiful and stunning example of Shekinah, glory. Shekinah being that gorgeous Hebrew word that was used by early Jewish theologians to describe the visible manifestation of God on earth. Shekinah literally means dwelling, or one who dwells, and refers to the divine presence of God. Want to explain an experience of the presence of God? Well, I think you really have to be there. And when you are, words will surely fail you, as Peter experienced and as those of us who have been at a birth or at bedside at the time of death may attest. And on more than a few occasions, I've seen the presence of God in this room and in this building and in the lives of you, the church community. And you know, it has been glorious. I dearly have loved to have been able to preserve those moments, and I suppose in some ways I've tried. Perhaps you have too. But like Peter discovered, it doesn't really work that way. They come, they go, and we hold on to them in our precious memory. Which brings me to our second thought. And that's, well, I've been wondering how Peter may have processed this event as the years passed by. Eventually, I have no doubt that as he retold the story, and he would surely have been asked to retell it over and over again, as he retold it, he surely began to see the parallels to another extraordinary and even more confusing event, the crucifixion. To quote from the writing of scholar Tom Wright, "Here on the mountain, Jesus is revealed in glory. There on a hill outside Jerusalem is Jesus revealed in shame. Here his clothes are shining white. There they have been stripped off, and soldiers have gambled for them. Here he is flanked by Moses and Elijah, two of Israel's greatest heroes, representing the law and the prophets. There he is flanked by two brigands, representing the level to which Israel had sunk in rebellion against God. Here a bright cloud overshadows the scene. There darkness comes upon the land. Here Peter blurts how wonderful it all is. There he is hiding in shame after denying he even knows Jesus. Here a voice from God himself declares that this is his wonderful son. There a pagan soldier declares in surprise that this really was God's son." Wright goes on to say, "The mountaintop explains the hilltop, and vice versa." I mentioned the Gospel of John some moments back, and one of its distinctives is how when he refers to Jesus' glory in the Gospel, John does so in reference to the crucifixion. From both the crucifixion and the transfiguration streams the glory of Shekinah. And now a final thought on this text for this morning. Those of you who might have been following along in your Bibles will have noted that I only quoted a part of what the voice from the cloud said. Just as the voice declared at Jesus' baptism, the voice at the Transfiguration said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with him I am well pleased." But on that day, on the Mount of Transfiguration, the voice also said, "Listen to him." It's not even "do what he says," it's simply "listen to him." Listen to him. We are about to enter the season of Lent. And on Wednesday, we begin to journey along with Jesus to that all-important week that begins in the illusion of triumph on Palm Sunday and closes with, and I'll borrow the expression from the insightful author Frederick Buechner, the magnificent defeat of Good Friday. There is much for us to do, I know. But perhaps we might temper our doing by first simply trying to listen for Jesus, to listen to Jesus over these next Lenten weeks. And in doing so, I dare say we might just catch a glimpse of Shekinah glory. Praise be to God. Amen.
Holy, 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 I want to see you. Good morning, my friends. As we pray and ask for God's blessings, remember a quote from Hans Urs von Balthasar: "What you are is God's gift to you. What you become is your gift to God." Today's prayers are responsive. I say, God of love, and you reply, grant our prayer. Loving God, we thank you for Diana, the staff who make St. Stephen's the caring community that it is. We ask that you care for all of them and let them feel our gratitude. God of love, grant our prayer. Gracious God, we also thank you for all those who volunteer at St. Stephen's, all who take time to share their love and caring for others. Please bless them all and keep them in your heart. God of love, grant our prayer. Holy and loving God, we come to you because we know that you listen and hear our prayers. Our prayer is simple but big. We need you. We need your grace, your comfort, your peace. We need you in a time when it feels like all we hear is bad news. Bring your gospel of freedom and liberation. We know from Scripture that wherever your spirit is, there is freedom. So, living spirit, may we feel your freedom like the wind over the shore. God of love, grant our prayer. Reveal yourself to us so we know how to move, live, and survive this world. We know your voice speaks to us in many ways, and yet sometimes we cannot hear. Can we ask you to speak a little louder so we might hear? If not, help us to lower the noisy distractions around us that keep us from loving mercy, doing justice, and walking humbly with you. God of love, grant our prayer. We pray for the nations around the world that are experiencing unrest and war. Keep people safe and help people deal with conflict with civility and righteousness. Power can be so consuming. So we ask for the world's leaders to have their hearts changed towards humility, empathy, self-control, and the ability to see people with human dignity. God of love, grant our prayer. We also pray for those whose lives today are complicated with stress of all kinds. It's easy to compare our pains to other people and say to you, you have other things to worry about. But we thank you that in the midst of a chaotic world, you still care about us. So be with those in our community who are dealing with stresses of all kinds. Comfort those waiting for a diagnosis. Bring peace to people whose minds are racing with decisions they need to make. Send hope to those in hospital beds or ill at home. And bring energy and rejuvenation to those caring for them. God of love, grant our prayer. I now share with you something from our hearts. Some of you may know about the medical issue my lovely wife Julie has experienced. As a relatively newly diagnosed epileptic, it was a frightening and concerning time. Diane learned of Julie's condition and immediately said she would alert the prayer group to pray for Julie. Julie started her medications for the condition, and since the prayer group asked for the Lord's help, she has not experienced another seizure and says she feels the best she has in 20 years. Thanks be to God and for the prayer group whose prayers he has heard. Holy God, may we embrace your steadfast love to embody empathy and grace in this world. We pray this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We thank you for your gifts of time, talent, and money that foster the ministries and works of this congregation. Let's pray together, giving those back to God to build his kingdom. Please pray with me. Gracious God, though we do not bear gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, we offer ourselves and what we have. The story continues. Good news abounds. Receive our gifts, O God. May they be used to show forth to the world the greatness of your love. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Christ, your perfect gift and our Saviour. Amen. A couple of announcements this week. On Wednesday, February 22nd, we are having an Ash Wednesday service here in the sanctuary. It's in person only at 9 o'clock. If you live locally and would like to join in that meaningful way of beginning Lent, please come and join us, 9 o'clock on Wednesday. And then next week, on the 26th, we're having one in-person service only at 10 o'clock. That service will be a combined service with both 11 o'clock components and 9 o'clock components. We would love to see you here. Following that service is the annual general meeting, 10 o'clock on Sunday. We would love to see you.
Go now to follow the way of Jesus, seeing others as he did, daring to give freely as he did, and loving unconditionally as he did. Go now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, yeah, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. I